Globally, we now consume 4 billion tons of oil every year. Oil spills from shipping accidents and offshore blowouts are rare, but when they happen, the impact on the environment, on livelihoods, and on the local economy can be severe. In this series, we'll be asking the key questions. What issues do we need to consider? What expertise and techniques are available? And how do we deliver a well-planned and executed response to minimize impact? In this program, we're going to be looking at the environmental impact of oil spills. From the immediate effects on ecosystems and habitats to prospects for long-term recovery. We've all seen the pictures of dead seabirds and oil-covered wildlife. They're among the most distressing, emotive images associated with oil spills. And while an incident remains in the public eye, these images can influence a great deal of debate and decision making. But what is the truth about the impact an oil spill can have on the environment? In 1996, the Sea Empress grounded here in Milford Haven and 10,000 tons of oil washed up on the Pembrokeshire shoreline. Many beaches, including Manabir, were heavily contaminated. Today, the damage caused by the spill is a distant memory. So what is the actual environmental impact of an oil spill? To answer this, I've enlisted the help of a marine ecologist with 30 years of professional research experience, John Moore. John, tell me about the impact that oil spills have on the environment.
You can't answer that in any simple way because the marine environment is a very complex place. There are large numbers of different habitats, different species, and they can all react very differently to the oil. Many spills look terrible, but many habitats have got very great powers of recovery, rapid recovery. So long-term impacts are actually unusual. Some species are longer lived, and recovery may take longer, but the majority will recover quickly.
The nature and duration of a spill's impact depend on a wide range of variables. The cleanup methods used are critical. When the Torrey Canyon ran aground in 1967, the use of industrial detergents with high concentrations of kerosene proved highly toxic to marine life, particularly as they were applied directly to the shoreline. By the time of the Exxon Valdez spill 22 years later, the use of those detergents in spill response had been eliminated. However, it still saw contractors on a number of beaches using hot water to clean the sensitive subarctic shorelines, which added to the overall impact of the spill. Today, the crucial importance of choosing response techniques that work with natural processes is much better understood.
The type of oil spill is also a key factor. For instance, refined products such as diesel have a high proportion of toxic compounds which can cause dramatic localized effects such as the mass mortalities of marine life, although these tend to be short term as these oils are also less persistent.
Whereas heavy fuel oil and heavy crude often have more of a smothering effect on marine life and persist longer in the marine environment. But equally important is the type of environment the oil has an impact upon. And when we consider individual habitats and the organisms within them, we need to think in terms of their vulnerability and sensitivity.
So taking those one by one, what do we mean by vulnerable? What do we mean by sensitive?
An example of a vulnerable organism might be seaweed on the shoreline. The oil is coming onto that shoreline, and so the seaweed is going to be affected, though it's very, very vulnerable. Doesn't necessarily mean it's sensitive. In fact, most seaweeds are not very sensitive to oil. An example of an organism that is not vulnerable would be, say, a deep water coral, and very sensitive, but not very vulnerable because the oil is unlikely to get there.
In a number of countries, shorelines have been mapped and indices attributed to different habitats according to sensitivity. For example, sensitivity atlases accord soft sediment habitats like mangroves or salt marshes a high index, while exposed rocky shores generally feature a low index.
So let's look at those different marine ecosystems and exactly what needs to be considered, starting with the offshore and coastal environments.
I want to find out how the way in which oil behaves after a spill determines the type of organisms that might be at risk.
Generally, when oil is spilt into the sea, it remains floating on the sea surface or just below the sea surface. And there it's spread with the actions of water currents, with wind, with waves. The heavier, the more viscous oils, they're considered more persistent, and they will remain in the environment for quite some time and clearly have the potential to come into contact and impact marine organisms in the sea.
One thing most people would think of is fish. I mean, are fish stocks affected?
I think it's fair to say that the impact of oil on wild finfish stocks has seldom been seen. Fish are considered to actively avoid oil, and therefore their exposure to oil and the potential to become contaminated is relatively low.
Are there any other living organisms that need to be considered?
It's understandable people have a concern about the impact of oil on plankton. Plankton contain many eggs and larvae of important marine organisms, and we know that they're sensitive to oil. Mm-hmm. However, plankton is influenced by so many natural factors, the breeding success of the adults, disease, predation, and therefore the populations are highly variable, and detecting impacts of oil alone is very, very difficult. And in addition, plankton has a great capacity to suffer mortality at the very early stages in the life cycle of marine organisms without it impacting the adult populations.
Some of the most vulnerable inhabitants of open water are seabirds. They're easily harmed by floating oil, and the distressing images of heavily oiled birds struggling to move have become something of an emblem of oil spills.
Species which dive for their food or congregate at the sea surface are particularly at risk, and even a relatively small spill can have a significant effect. In 2007, the container ship MSC Napoli ran into difficulty in rough seas in the English Channel and was deliberately beached off the Devon coast to avert a major incident. Around 50 tons of heavy fuel were spilled. Not a large spill, but enough to have an impact on sensitive species. Before long, oiled seabirds, and in particular guillemots, began washing up on the shoreline. The RSPCA was part of the wildlife response team.
Oil affects seabirds primarily because it'll get to their feathers, it'll mat the feathers together. What that does is prevent them from diving, it prevents them from flying. If they can't dive, they can't get food. The problem is that their fluids also come wrapped with their food, so they start to dehydrate very quickly. And because the feathers are also matted, they lose the ability to regulate their body temperature. They can't thermoregulate, so they get cold, they get hypothermic. Combine that with dehydration and, over a period of time, starvation, they go downhill, body condition goes, and they can die if they're not rescued.
Rescue teams administered rehydration solution on site, and around 900 guillemots were then taken to the West Hatch RSPCA Centre for rehabilitation. After the oil was cleaned from their feathers, they were kept at the rehab centre and carefully monitored for about 8 weeks. Those birds which then met pre-designated criteria were passed as healthy enough for release.
During the Napoli, we admitted 908 guillemots from the area, and we managed to rehabilitate 450 of those birds. It was 49.3%, so about the percentage we would have expected to have released after a spill and the process of rehabilitation that we use.
For larger spills, where birds are affected over a wider area, the rehab rate is often much lower. The Erica spill in 1999 resulted in 63,000 oiled seabirds being collected. Only 2,150 were successfully cleaned and released, representing 14% of the total taken in. But given the right circumstances, a well-planned response, and a resilient species, rehabilitation rates can be a lot higher. Following the treasure spill in South Africa, 19,000 African penguins were cleaned and 90% were successfully released. For most species, while recovery of the population will take several years, there's little evidence of spills causing long-term damage to colonies as a whole. Like seabirds, mammals, such as seals and otters that breed on shorelines, are likely to come into contact with oil, and those which use fur to regulate body temperature are vulnerable to hypothermia or overheating if the fur becomes matted. Floating oil may also threaten marine reptiles. In particular, turtles are vulnerable during nesting season.
Another key habitat to consider is shallow inshore waters. Spill damage in areas like this is most likely to occur when, instead of floating on the surface, the oil is dispersed in high concentration in the water column. And in cases where wave action disperses substantial volumes of oil in close inshore waters, then mass mortalities of marine life, particularly invertebrates, have occurred.
The light toxic components of crude oil can particularly affect bivalve mollusks, which eject themselves from the sediment and are left gaping and vulnerable to predators. Corals are unlikely to encounter oil, so aren't particularly vulnerable, but they are sensitive. So if they do come into contact with dispersed oil over a prolonged period of time, for example if oil gets trapped in mangroves near coral reefs and is then slowly released, then they can take a long time to recover. Moving now from nearshore to shoreline habitats, soft sediment shores of fine sands and mud tend to be highly biologically productive, often supporting large populations of migrating birds and sediment-dwelling invertebrates. Oil can end up buried here in fine sediments, sometimes persisting for many years. On sheltered areas of shoreline with soft, muddy sediments, you can often find salt marshes in temperate climates and mangroves in the tropics.
John, tell me about this area and how it might be affected by oil.
This is a salt marsh, a habitat that we find in very sheltered locations in the upper parts of the shoreline, where water movement is so limited, and so oil, if it did come in here, would not come out very so easily by natural means. But where also we need to be very, very careful about how we might try to clean it up. In fact, generally we leave it alone because we can do so much more physical damage. In tropical climates, in the same sort of shelter locations, we have mangrove, and again, largely we have to leave them alone and let nature take its course.
Mangroves are both sensitive and vulnerable. Their root systems are at high risk of becoming contaminated, and the trees can take many years to recover. They're a vital habitat to protect, not least as they provide nursery grounds for coral reefs and nearshore fish stocks. Rocky shorelines that are exposed to rough seas are understandably areas where spills are likely to occur.
But the good news is that the communities of animals and plants that inhabit these areas are actually pretty resilient, as they've adapted to pounding waves and drying winds. And rocky areas where marine life has been lost after a spill tend to be recolonized fairly rapidly.
Exposed rocky and sandy shores tend to recover particularly quickly after oil spills due to the scouring effect of the waves and the flushing of the tides. I've now seen how a range of marine ecosystems might fare after a spill. But I'm still curious about what constitutes a successful recovery. So I'm meeting up again with Mark Whittington from ITOPF. Thank you.
When is it possible to say that an ecosystem has recovered after a spill?
Recovery is difficult to define. However, a commonly accepted definition is when a community has all its characteristic plants and animals present and functioning normally. However, it should be recognised that the abundance of individual plants and animals may well be different after a spill than they were before the spill. And also you'll have the underlying natural fluctuations in abundances, regardless of whether there's been a spill or not.
When people see a large oil spill on the news, the message seems to be it's an environmental disaster. I suppose we have to remember, though, the natural environment does have processes and mechanisms to start helping itself recover.
Certainly, and I think we can look at two main factors that can assist with that recovery. First is the natural cleaning potential of the marine environment. So you have the physical cleaning action of the waves, of the weather, and that's combined with the marine microbes that can use oil as a food and help to break it down. And secondly, marine plants and animals have developed life strategies to deal with what is a dynamic environment, and so they're able to cope to a large extent with natural fluctuations or man-made events.
I suppose, though, we have to remember these strategies would be completely overwhelmed in the early days of an oil spill with an abundance of oil around.
Certainly, and the priority has got to be to do everything we can to prevent a spill in the first place, because an oil spill does have the potential to cause impacts to the marine environment, and particularly where we have sensitive species or sensitive habitats, those impacts can be quite acute or extend over a prolonged period.
And when you're dealing with sensitive areas, just how important is it that the cleanup operation, the techniques used, don't actually make the problem worse?
A cleanup strategy should aim to minimise the impacts and to help promote recovery. And so we'll always look at the net environment benefit of a particular response strategy being considered.
Of course, no one wants an oil spill to occur, but what we've seen is that the marine environment has a great capacity for natural recovery. If you can remove the bulk oil and thereby reduce the geographic extent of the oil and the time it's in contact with sensitive areas, then over a period of months, the marine environment can restore itself and the ecosystem rarely suffers any long-term damage. And for more details on any of the issues in this series, have a look at the ITOPF technical information papers at itopf.com/tips.